Good morning, we have a little delay. We have the presentation of the work package E-Marea project about resilience engineering. We have three partners in this project, but because of the reduced time for the seminar, we're only going to introduce two parts of the work. One part will be, and he was also the project leader, introduced by Siebert Struve from NLR about cognitive modeling and other things. He will say that. And then we will have a mathematical appendix to the work by the University of Aquila. Maria de Benedetto will introduce that work. Without any delay, Siebert, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Marea, a mathematical approach towards resilience engineering in ATM, was done by people from NLR. Henk Blom and Marieke Everdijk from NLR also worked on it. From Vrije Universiteit Amsterdam, there were Thibaut Bosse, Jan Treur, Alexei Szczepanski and Natalia Moglis working on it. And from the University of Aquila, quite a team which Marieke de Benedetto will introduce in her part of the presentation later. I will talk, first introduce resilience and the objective of Marea. And then I will introduce agent-based modeling for analysis of resilience in air traffic management. Development of a library of model constructs, agent-based model constructs in support of analysis of resilience, integration and application of agent-based model constructs. And then Marieke Di Benedetto will talk about the application of arenas of hybrid systems to a future TMA operation. So that's more detailed mathematical, and then I will have a few conclusions to end with. The term resilience, it's a diagram for the use, and Google Ngram diagram for the use of the term resilience. So it's used quite more frequently. It used to be a term also for resilience in a material, mechanical way. But in the mid-1970s, Hollings wrote a paper who introduced resilience for the ecosystems. Then it popularized quite a bit. In the 1990s, there was a transfer to many social science topics. And for the ATM domain and for safety management, the resilience engineering was in the beginning of this millennium introduced by Holmagel and other people who made it popular. And I think that's why we also are here from a safety perspective looking at resilience. So if we look at what then definitions are from social ecological systems, resilience is defined as the capacity of a system to absorb disturbances and to reorganize while undergoing change and still to retain essentially the same function, same structure, same identity and feedback. And if you look at how it has been defined in a white paper of Eurocontrol written by Jörg Holmagel and others, then it's about similar. So the intrinsic ability of a system to adjust its functioning prior to, during, following changes and disturbances so that it can still sustain required operations under both expected and unexpected conditions. So it's dealing with changes and disturbances, reorganizing, and by that flexibility is still trying to keep operations going on well. And the human role is very important in resilience, in air traffic management, also in other fields. So the flexibility and oversight by human operators, pilots and controllers are seen as very important to keep it going on efficiently and safely in all kind of situations. Resilience engineering emphasizes performance variability of human operators quite a lot. So it goes away from pure human error thinking, so that has been done, of course, in safety assessments quite a bit, but it emphasizes more the variability in the performance that is also needed to account for all kind of disturbances, and which is also by human nature. So humans are not machines which will act every time in the same way. So there are positive and sometimes negative aspects to such performance variability. In Marea, we want to develop a mathematical approach towards resilience engineering and ATM. So a lot of the resilience engineering research has been quite qualitative, and we thought it would be good to structure it more and to develop mathematical models for that, especially for a complex system as air traffic management is, given the importance of human performance for achieving resilience. So a lot of focus will then be also on human performance models, so how humans deal with uncertainties and non-nominal conditions. And so they will, psychological and organizational models will be a key part of it.
Can I ask a question at this point? Do you discriminate between robustness and resilience specifically?
No, we don't make that distinction specifically. In CSR 61.2, so there has been such a distinction, but the distinction from my perspective is not very clear between robustness and resilience. Both are about how to deal with disturbances, and some disturbances are maybe a bit better, could be known more in advance than others, but I think the distinction is also a bit artificial, not really needed, and we don't make such a distinction here, so we look at it in a more general way, I think. This is just to introduce the concept of agent-based modeling, not for an ATM, but for a predator-prey system. It's about foxes and rabbits living in a particular environment. It's a simple agent-based system on a grid with foxes and rabbits, and there are some rules so that if a fox is near to a rabbit, then the fox will eat the rabbit, the rabbit will go away, and if there's some empty squares, then fox or rabbits may be born, and there are a number of rules who should specify how the foxes and rabbits survive and may die. And as a result of those rules, you can look at the size of the populations of rabbits and foxes. So as a result of those rules, so this is the emergent behavior in an agent-based simulation stemming from those rules. As an example, and it's a bit probabilistic, there's some noise on it, but there's just some simple rules and you get this oscillating behavior, which can also be predicted or modeled by more coupled differential equations, which has been done here. So there's no stochastics on these. So there's without any noise effects, as you can see. But that's not an emerging behavior. But here we have the emerging behavior from the rules there. So that's an example how from some simple rules model constructs, so you can say, which describe the performance of those animals, how that turns into in population dynamics.
Can I just ask this is a sort of fairly classic known example.
How does this compare with examples, with real data that's known? Are you able to tune your models to match real data? And how successful are the different approaches? Which is the best approach to take?
We're not modeling predator-prey systems within Marea, so I will say a lot more about the models which we developed for ATM. So maybe it's better to come back to that question then a bit later. That's okay with you. For air traffic management, we think that agent-based models for social technical systems is also very useful. So this is a generic agent-based model with human operators as agents, technical systems. They interact and they live in a particular environment, which can also be modeled, for instance, weather or wind conditions. And it's to describe the micro level, you have particular model constructs within each of those agents, which can describe particular aspects of the behavior of technical systems, of human operators. And so that's at the micro level. And then at the macro level, there's a particular behavior which emerges from all those interactions, just as for the foxes and the rabbits. And you can then look at particular resilience indicators for whether required operations are still sustained, given that there are particular disturbances. And what we need then is a quite large variety of model constructs of disturbances and performance variability in the socio-technical systems of organizational factors for human operators, well, just maybe creativity, also errors you can think of for technical systems. You can model the performance of radar systems. You can include technical failures. There's a whole quite diversity of model constructs that you need within such an aging-based model of a socio-technical system. So what we did within Marea, we took hazards as descriptions of disturbances and performance variability in ATM. So we define hazards as quite broadly as anything that may have an effect on safety. So any event, any condition, any performance aspects of technical systems, of human operators and the interactions between them. A lot of hazards in years of safety assessments have been gathered at NLR in a large database by hazard brainstorm sessions, typically involving pilots and air traffic controllers and other experts. And those are pure brainstorming sessions without any analysis, so we always stimulate people to come up with a lot of different events, performance variations that they may think of, so it's quite a rich database of hazards. And what we did within Marea, we looked at the more than 4,000 hazards that we collected within all those safety assessments, and we made a selection of all the unique hazards and we generalized them, so specific airport characteristics, etc. So they were left out, but so we selected unique ones and generalized them to come up at a total set of 525 different hazards. Well, these are just some examples having to do with all kind of confusions, errors of pilots and controllers, of technical systems, of weather-related aspects. So it's quite a broad range of events that may occur. So we split all those hazards in a set which we used for the model development and a set for the model validation. So the development of the model constructs was done by three sources, three phases. So first we looked at model constructs which we already have in NLR Topaz multi-agent dynamic risk modeling. So we looked at model constructs used in agent research at VU University Amsterdam, and we had other sources. And the basis of it, which kind of model constructs can then model the set of hazards. So first, short about Topaz multi-agent dynamic risk modeling. At NLR, we've been using agent-based modeling for safety assessments quite a while now. So if there's some operation with interacting human operators, technical systems, so this is for kind of runway incursion scenario, there may be all kind of hazards defining the performance of human operators, interactions between alerting systems, there are hazards which can be coupled to those interactions. Models, PetriNet models, stochastically and dynamically colored PetriNet models are used for those, and Monte Carlo simulations and speed-up methods are then used to get results such as accident risk contributions by various agents, risk sensitivity results, so what are important effects for accident risks. Can also think of probability density functions of safety related variables. For instance, if this is the distance to a runway threshold, at what distance might a pilot flying of a taxiing aircraft detect a conflict of a runway incursion, and at what time can a controller warn a pilot. So these are results from agent-based modeling for safety assessments. So these are the kind of results that we can obtain by the agent-based modeling for the safety assessments. And within those models, we use various model constructs. Human information processing includes expected task identification, task load, task scheduling, task execution and decision making. So it has to do, so what kind of task has a human operator to perform now, given his situation awareness of his environment, so setting priorities in the task scheduling and then performing the tasks. Multi-agent situation awareness is an important model construct. So within a multi-agent system with interactions between agents, Each agent K has a particular situation awareness of other agents. That includes then what's the identity of an agent, state variables, for instance, position, speeds, modes, the intent, what will an agent do next. So these are the those components, and there are situation updating processes like observation, communication, and reasoning. Cognitive control mode, it's one originally defined by Erik Holnagel. It's about degree of control that a human operator has in general as a function of the subjectively available time. So if there's a lot of time available for an operator, it will be in a strategic mode, and in such strategic mode he will plan long time ahead, take a lot of measures to make sure that the operation is going well. And if it's going more in an opportunistic mode, then he has to react very quickly. The subjectively available time is shorter, so degree of control is lower, and the error probability in such cases may be higher in this region. So I couple that to a human error construct, which are about deviations from normal or intended practice, which is also a probabilistic model within agent-based modeling for safety assessments. And then there are models for system modes, so particular modes of technical systems. We describe within those models dynamic variability just by differential equations, stochastic variability, and there are modes for contextual conditions such as weather. And what we did now in Marea, we tried to match those model constructs with all the hazards of the hazard sets used for the identification and the development of models. So that was done by multiple analysts for each hazard. So if there's a particular hazard, for instance, pilots do not react to a controller call due to high workload, then we tried to identify what kind of constructs, in this case from the Topaz constructs, could be used to model this. This case, so we think that cognitive control mode is related to the high workload that implies that you will be, for instance, in an opportunistic control mode. There's not a lot of subjectively available time is low. And then that means that for task identification and not all constructs, maybe if there's an incoming call, so that it's maybe identified, but it's seen as unimportant, and therefore it gets a low priority, and it may then apply that there will be no response from the pilots to the control call, as it was set in the hazard. So these are then the model constructs, cognitive control, task identification, task scheduling, which can be coupled to this hazard. And this was done for all hazards in the hazard list. So that is then a qualitative reasoning about the applicability of those model constructs. And then we can say, well, it's well modeled. Maybe some aspects are missing, then we call it partly modeled, or we don't have any model constructs for it, then it's not modeled. And if we then look at results for the modeling of the hazards by the initial set of Topaz multi-agent dynamic risk model constructs, so then we think that, about 60% of those hazards are well modeled. There are some examples like making reading errors. So you can read here. Some are not so well modeled, and some we don't have any models for yet. Then we did the same for identification of few model constructs, and then we came up with those additional model constructs about bottom-up attention, experience-based decision-making, and operator functional states. Presentation of information and how that is being interpreted by human operators, models for safety culture, which have been developed in earlier research, complex beliefs, so more higher reasoning within situation awareness, trust, formal organizations, models for that, learning effects, and goal-oriented attention and extended mind. Well, just to give an example for operator functional state, we developed this model, which about matching particular task demands from the environment with the coupling it to task goals, and so the central key is here the effort and the experienced pressure. So the experience pressure may be getting too high above critical points, which means that particular actions cannot be performed quite well. So that's an operational functional state model then gives more relations between efforts which must be provided by operators, and so can describe human performance in particular stress situations better. Another one is for trust. So for trust there were several model constructs developed. So this is the most simple one. It's about stress as particular modes: unconditional trust, conditional and more conditional distrust, and unconditional distrust, and transfer between those modes. After the identification of model constructs from VU, there were more model constructs, additional hazards that we could model well. For instance, a controller being fatigued and sleepy, so that could be linked to the operator functional state model, or clutter of audio messages can be linked to the information presentation. So that's a new one, together with situation awareness that we already had. Or trust, it's about the confidence in validity of system alerts. So some examples of hazards that we could now describe better by those models. But some other ones we did not have complete models for yet. And then we looked further into the literature and we identified those additional model constructs for an unstabilized approach for handling inconsistent information by technical systems, suboptimal emotional atmosphere between people, complex or unclear procedures, or changes in procedures which lead to confusion. Model constructs about human operators who do not know when to take action. Problems with access rights to information systems, merging or splitting of HC6 sectors, reduced visibility, weather forecast being wrong, strong turbulence, icing, kind of environmental aspects, and influence of many agents on flight planning and uncontrolled aircraft. We also have some more mathematics behind these kind of constructs, such as the suboptimal emotional atmosphere, which is about the influence of emotional state, anger to other persons and how that may transfer.
Is it for everyday use as well?
Well, you could give it a try. Or as another one, changes in procedures leading to confusion. It's about evaluation of particular events and expectation disconfirmation, which may exist, which may lead to particular surprise. And if it's novel, it's very novel, then it's weighted higher. So there's a particular surprise intensity. If there's surprise, there's a need for sense making, trying to understand what is actually happening, and that leads to particular beliefs on the situations, which may be wrong, of course. So that is a way to how change in procedures may lead to confusion, and what that has for effect on the reasoning of an agent.
How do you come up with these constructs? I mean, these are new constructs that you've created. How was that particular example created?
It's also an extension of work already done at constructs related to confusion. So it was identified in that in their research. I don't know exactly how they developed this one, but from the psychological literature, so these are, qualitative notions, expecting disconfirmation, which are important, which may lead to surprise. And so those qualitative aspects from psychological literature are then combined in states, and relations between them are being laid, and that leads then to such kind of model.
Is this evidence-based? Is it logical argumentation? What is the process for creating a diagram like this? How could I do it if I wanted to do it myself?
Mm-hmm. It's based on concepts in psychological literature and laying relations between them. So it's for part based on evidence from the literature in psychology, so stating that there are particular relations, and then it's logically reasoning about relations between those concepts and trying to coming up with these kind of diagrams models. After this additional set of models, almost all of the hazards could be well modeled, or some partly, or some dealing with, for instance, security or unmanned aerial vehicles or military aircraft, which we did not have model constructs for, but for the large majority of hazards, we do now have constructs to deal with them and to include them within agent-based models.
You say unmanned aerial vehicles are not modeled well, but a jolly atmosphere on the frequency is modeled well. Is that true interpretation of that?
Yeah, that's just the right interpretation. So we think that with the operational functional state model and the emotion contagion, so the influence of emotions between human operators, so that it provides a good basis to describe a jolly atmosphere on the frequency. And for unmanned aerial vehicles, we did not look at that in our modeling, so that is not modeled. So that's the verdict in this case. Okay, what I talked about was for the development, so that was in the first half of the hazards, so there we started with the initial model set, so which is only the Topaz ones and the final ones. So there's been quite an increase in the way that those hazards can be modeled. And for the other half, the validation set, we did after we stopped this development, we did the same, and actually we got similar results as the final model set for how well they are modeled. So about 92% we think can be well modeled, about 8% partly, and in this case we only found two hazards which we think we cannot model at all. So it seems model development, it was not tuned towards the particular hazards in our set. And if we look at what model constructs were used most frequently to represent the hazards, multi-agent situation awareness is used for modeling more than 40% of the hazards, so that's a very important model construct, of course, in an agent-based system. So it's about confusion between human operators, so it's knowing about others what they should know, also about technical systems, what human operator knows or does not know. So it can be used a lot to describe all kinds of hazards. Then system modes and human error and human information processing are about used in 20% of the cases, so also quite a lot. New model constructs, so situation awareness with complex belief and operational functional state and experience-based decision making, they are used also quite a lot for representation of the hazards. We integrated those model constructs at a higher level. So this is for the human agent. So these are all model constructs relevant for human agents. So they can be grouped in particular blocks for sensing, sense mating. So sense making is gathered around multi-agent situation awareness, deciding and actuating of human operator. And those are being influenced by the task planning and by the operator functional state, dealing with operator functional state, task load, cognitive control modes, and interactions between those. And all those constructs interact with other constructs which are in the environment of a human agent. So that may be other human agents, but also technical systems or environmental issues. So this provides a more global overview of the integration of the model construct for a human agent. We also formalized some of those integrated model constructs. So I will not go into detail in this presentation. So there are some results presented in our deliverables and papers. So they indicate so how those constructs, how they may be coupled, and also an example of simulation results which may be achieved by such modeling. And of course there are a lot of more results of formalization and simulation results in various papers on Topaz results, Topaz multi-agent dynamic risk modeling and few agent-based modeling applications. So what we also did as part of the whole assessment of resilience, we had, and of the models, so we had interviews with pilots and controllers. That was done in two phases at the beginning of the project. So we interviewed 5 controllers to airline pilots about how they deal with hazards. So we already had then the list of hazards which we identified, and then we asked for a large number of those hazards. So how may operators detect and interpret the situations described in the hazards, what kind of impact has it on the behavior, in what ways may we deal with it, and what are relations with written procedures. So that has been documented within a Marea D12 deliverable. So it's quite an extensive overview of manifestation of practical performance variability resulting from hazards. Well, and not as a surprise, so for a lot of hazards there are no written procedures, and so pilots and controllers react in various ways based upon their training experience and what they regard as normal work, but not always following particular written procedures. So another set of interviews was done after we developed the agent-based models. Then we also interviewed 5 controllers and 2 airline pilots, different ones for a part, some were the same people. And then we discussed the relevant model constructs by some historic incident scenarios, as runway incursions or landing at wrong airports. And we described how the model constructs might be used to describe those kind of scenarios. And then we asked the interviewees to provide feedback on the plausibility of the model constructs, aspects that may be adapted to improve them, additional aspects for which model constructs are needed, and their feedback on the agent-based modeling approach as such in general. Some of the suggestions, their opinions mostly confirmed that states of processes are well adopted in the model constructs as we have them already. But some models may be enhanced, for instance, addressing intake of alcohol or medicine in the operator functional state model may further extend that model, and so that it can describe also these kind of situations. So suggestions for new model constructs. So we had already a construct for group emotion, but the emotion within a human operator or human itself, and so it's not very well described yet, so that may be improved. And in general, so the pilots and controllers recognize the value of agent-based modeling as a way to capture dynamics and interactions between agents and relevant processes in ATM, going beyond a more linear process of events. So then, we assess the Marea approaches. How can it be used within safety analysis of design? Well, we saw that the variety of agent-based model constructs supports quite direct representation of many hazards, and that is quite different from more traditional approaches in probabilistic safety assessment and human reliability assessments, which basically are based on human error probabilities and error-producing condition factors to try to reason about all kind of hazards and errors and variability. And in this way, agent-based modeling can support resilience analysis better by looking at what kind of changes in the behavior may result from all kind of disturbances. Well, we've quite a large set of model constructs, and is a practical way for efficient application of agent-based modeling. We also propose a minimal modeling approach, which chooses some of the most important model constructs to define the agent-based models, and then do qualitative reasoning based on a search assessment, we call that, on the results to also describe possible effect of other model constructs. Well, we have in previous studies already showed that multi-agent dynamic risk modeling can be effectively applied in phases V1 to V3 of the EOCVM. And for the additional model constructs, so with the minimal modeling approach, that can especially also then be applied to V1 application when operations are not yet well defined, and the more extensive model construct set may then also be in the later phases applied more effectively. Okay, so this was the first part of the presentation. So then I will give now the floor to Marieke Di Benedetto, and after the presentation I will come back with some conclusions on the work.
So I will present the work that we did at University of L'Aquila, which is a university very close to Rome, actually, and in collaboration in particular with the NLR. The objective of our work at L'Aquila was, first of all, to model and analyze safety-critical operations in ETM. Of course, our work is based on formal models, These models depend on the level of abstraction at which you want to analyze the system. With respect to what Seibert has just illustrated, it is a little bit different because we are at a higher level of abstraction. We are not going into so many details about the behavior of, for example, the human operators. And one particular aspect that we were considering was the fact that it is a large-scale system. And so when you want to analyze such a complex system, it is very difficult to have tools that you can apply without having a lot of complexity in the computations and in the mathematical approach. Just to show what happens at this level, we have to deal with the heterogeneous systems. For example, human operators, aircraft, etc. If I want to model the aircraft, I will use nonlinear differential equations, while if I want to model the behavior of a human operator at a certain level of abstraction, I can use automata or finite state machines, so systems with a finite number of states. From a mathematical point of view, when you want to compose these kind of systems, you have to define the common mathematical framework because you end up with hybrid systems. So systems which are composed with different models of computation. And the hybrid system is an entity that is very precisely defined from a mathematical point of view. So this is what we adopted as a model of computation, hybrid system. Then if each agent of the system can be described by a hybrid system, so the aircraft agent or the tactical controller agent, etc., we have also to define rules for the composition of this system. These rules also have to be precise because we have to specify what is the exact interaction between all these systems. We define what we call an arena of hybrid systems by defining a direct graph with a collection of hybrid systems that represent the nodes of the arena, and the communication network among these hybrid systems can be described by this relation E. So this is an arena of hybrid system. So each agent will be represented by a hybrid system inside each of these boxes, and the number of states in the arena will increase exponentially in the number of states of each agent. We start by modeling nominal conditions for each agent. We get either a hybrid system in general, but for example here I represent the crew, the behavior of the crew at a certain level of abstraction. If I want to represent non-nominal conditions, I have to add states that I will call critical. So I will add some set of critical states that I find here in blue that represent, for example, dangerous situations and hazards or consequences of hazards. So to obtain this kind of model for the agents that are in this ATM operation, and we chose a particular one, of course, we used the database that Seibert was explaining and that was derived in at NLR, choosing some significant hazards, not all of them, because it was too complex, but the methodology is absolutely general, so it can be extended to any kind of complexity that arises from taking into account the hazards that we want. What is the goal then? The objective is to understand if the system is what we call critically observable. This means that we want to understand if, on the basis of the available information that we have on the system, for example, measurements on the velocity, the position of the aircraft, etc., we are able to detect if the state of the system is a critical state or not. So if the critical state, for example, is a state of pre-alarm for the system, we want to understand if, from the available information that we have, from the technical systems, etc., we can understand if we can give this alarm or not. We want to build this system that is called observer in the picture, system that from the input of the global system and from the output, so the measurements, the available information, can get the idea of the state of the system, in particular the critical states are of interest. So what is the problem here? The problem is that the system is hybrid, okay? It is an arena of a hybrid system, so it is a very complex system. And so it is not very complicated to build the observer, but it is the complexity that is important here, the number of states. What we want to do is to simplify the system. So to reduce complexity, we have the original system, we want to simplify it, but we want to keep a sort of equivalence between the original system and the reduced one. An equivalence with respect to the property that we want to check. The property in particular that we want to check in this work is critical observability, but of course this idea can be generalized to other properties. And the kind of equivalence that will be used, of course, will be a little bit different, because we want to keep, by equivalence, the property of the original system on the reduced one. In this particular case, we can group agents that are equivalent in the sense that they are of the same type, for example, two aircraft. They have, in the procedure that we want to analyze, have the same role, for example, two aircraft that are performing a SID. They communicate with equivalent agents, so we want to keep the equivalence of the communication network of the original system. And also, they share critical situations with equivalent agents, in the sense that we would like to keep the criticality properties between the original system and the original one. So if we do this, we can introduce a mathematical definition of what we call compositional bisimulation. The bisimulation is a tool that in computer science is very well known for building equivalent systems. And in this case, we have derived some definitions of bisimulations for hybrid system, first of all, and also bisimulation, the equivalence we want to derive, for composition of systems. There is another word here that is the critical word, critical composition of bisimulation, because not only we want to keep the structure of the composition of the system, but we also want to keep the property of critical observability. For example, in this picture, we have the agents that are represented by these boxes. And for example, H2 and H2 prime are of the same type. H3 and H3 prime are of the same type. There is a communication network here, described by these arrows. A link like this means that information is sent or measured by this system H3 from the system H1. If there is a double arrow, this means that there is communication in the both directions. And also, we want to represent the what we call the critical relation, in the sense that are these two systems in a critical relation? This means, okay, I am an agent. I can have critical situations by myself, in the sense that, for example, there is an instrument that does not work on the aircraft or whatever. But there are critical situations that can be that can arise from the interaction of the system, two, three, four systems, etc. Because, for example, there are two aircraft that are in a vicinity, they are close to each other, and they do some operations that cannot be done if they are close. For example, if these are two models for the crew, there are critical states that are in the critical relation of the two agents that are not necessarily in one single agent. For example, this state corresponds to maneuver that is a change in the flight plan for conflict avoidance. But the change in the flight plan can be done in isolation, but cannot be done at the same time as the other aircraft if the two aircraft are in the vicinity. So this is a critical situation arising from the interaction of the two agents. So if we use this tool, it is some kind of an algorithm once you have set the mathematical definition of critical compositional bisimulation, you can reduce the given arena to a more simple one. So for example, in this very, very simple example, I reduce from 5 hybrid systems to 3. What is ensured by this equivalence is that if you check the critical observability of this reduced arena, you get the same result as if you were checking this property on the original one. So you are reducing the complexity of your analysis. In this project, we chose a particular operation, the TM81 operation, in collaboration with NLR. We described this operation with respect to critical observability. The aim of this operation is to reduce distance between SID routes and star routes. We thought it was a good benchmark because it contains significant features of the CESAR 2020 concept. We chose 5 agents that are described here, so aircraft agent, air traffic controller, human-machine interface, cockpit, human-machine interface, tactical controller agent, and aircraft crew agent. We selected some hazards from the ones that Seibert was describing, the more significant one, we think, in such an operation. The failure of the FMS, the failure of cockpit display and failure of the controller pilot data link communication, the false alert of an airborne system, the short-term conflict alert, and the misunderstanding of controller instruction by pilot. So by selecting these hazards, we had to then model the TMA-81 operation, as I was explaining, with the arena of hybrid system, and introduce this hazard in the model. For example, if I take this model of the aircraft crew, there are some critical states that are characteristic of this agent that correspond, for example, this simple state Q8 to the crew in heavy workload, or Q10 is the pilot misinterpreting communication of control statements, etc. Also, we have to introduce in the model of this operation the critical states that are due to the interactions of all the agents. So we selected the scenario, a simple one, it can be generalized to a more complex one, where there were three SID aircraft present, two STAR, three cruise route, and one air traffic controller HMI and one air traffic controller, and with different colors here. And also, we had to understand when the aircraft are close in such a way that some operations cannot be done at the same time by two, three, or four aircraft. In CESAR 2020, whenever two aircraft are closer than 3 nautical miles apart in horizontal direction, while being closer than 1,000 feet apart in vertical direction, they are said to be in conflict. So we enlarge this zone a little bit, and if you have 4 aircraft, for example, in this situation, you can define a critical relation 2x2, 3x3, etc., due to this kind of vicinity of the aircraft. So if we do this, not only we define the scenario with all the agents and their characteristics and the communication network, but also we can define another kind of network, which is the critical relation, which represents the criticalities that are due not only to the single agents, but also to the relations between them. If we look at the space complexity of the system, we see that the number of states is very, very high, even for this very simple example. So the order is 10 to the 18. While if we reduce this system with the critical composition by simulation, we have a reduction of the complexity to 10 to 9. So we can build the observers. There is a tool for building the observers, but we can build an observer for the reduced system. So this simplifies things a lot. What we have as a result of this analysis is that some hazards can be detected in the sense of critical observability, for example, failure of FMS or false alert of an airborne system, but hazards that cannot be detected are, for example, these in this list, a failure of cockpit display or misunderstanding of controller instruction. What is also important in the methodology that is not described in the deliverable, but that we have done in our work, is to also understanding how to get critical observability if the system is not critically observable. For example, if there are hazards that cannot be detected, what is the minimal additional information that you have to add to the system in such a way that it will become critically observable? Okay, so this can be useful, we hope, for ATM systems in the sense that trying to understand what is the information that can solve these kind of problems. The analysis that we did on this particular operation also showed that some safety critical situation can be detected, for example, some other critical situations that can arise from the interactions of this system. So, for example, the critical states that I was showing before can be detected. Also, when 3 agents are operating there are critical situations, also this one can be detected. Just some conclusion of this part of the work. We propose a mathematical framework for modeling these heterogeneous systems in ATM procedure. A framework that is compositional, in the sense that we can very precisely define the composition of the system and the interaction between the agents. We defined what is critical observability for arenas of hybrid systems, that is our mathematical framework, in order to analyze hazards. And we proposed algorithms for the reduction of complexity for checking these properties on the arena and also on the original system. We analyzed the TM81 operation. These results show that some hazards are not critically observable, so cannot be detected on the available information.
To conclude, overall, we developed within Marea two main mathematical approaches that can be used for prospective analysis, future situations for resilience engineering and ATM. The agent-based modeling of hazards in ATM, which I spoke about, and the arena of hybrid systems for identifying safety-critical conditions that Marieke Di Benedetto talked about. In doing this work, we extended a library of agent-based model constructs with quite a variety of human, environmental and organizational models. Those constructs can model well more than 90% of a large set of hazards. Of course, a large advantage is that emergent effects of interactions between those model constructs can arise in agent-based models and thus provide new insights in resilience in complex operations. For safety assessment, agent-based modeling has already been shown to be feasible, and we think that that extended set of model constructs can also support further analysis of safety-related resilience in air traffic management. I would like to thank all controller and pilots who contributed to the interview sessions. CESAR joint undertaking for the support of organizing those interview sessions and funding, and especially also Marc Bourgeois for his effective support of this research.
Can you tell, please, something more about the case when the system is not critically observable, what kind of techniques are you using? Because you said that in some cases it is not critically observable. So.
Yes, this means that you cannot get information about the hazard or critical situation from the available information. So in this case, what we can, we have tools for understanding what kind of information can be added to the system in such a way that this becomes critically observable.
But are you using probabilistic models?
No, we are using deterministic ones.
Even if there is this stochastic element when you don't know if it is critically observable or not?
In our case, we just don't use probabilities. So you don't get the probability of having such a critical state in the sense that the model is deterministic and you only want to know if, in case this happens, then can you detect it or not? Mm-hmm. If you cannot, whatever is the probability, you have to add some information. Mm-hmm. Then if you want to go deeper in the analysis, you can put probabilities, but we didn't do it yet.
Okay, thanks. You've got a massive amount of information and quite complicated models. How do you go from this to actually presenting some lessons to CESAR, for example? So they're developing concepts and validation exercises and so on and so forth. It would be nice if you could run your model through a big simulation, and then some kind of lessons come out that you could go back to CESAR and say, look, you need to look at this, this and this area, because this is where we think you have some kind of issues. How can you do that?
Well, so we already applied it by the work of Marieke Di Benedetto for parts and in general. So we always like to apply those agent-based models in particular CESAR operations. We showed it already. We applied it in safety assessments already, and we can now add more model constructs. So the particular assets which we could not directly cover in agent-based models are now more directly. So we'd like to do that. There will also be a Framework 7 program, Resilience 2050, which is ongoing now, and which we, I think, I will try to also include some of the models that we developed here as a way for showing their value. So those are some opportunities for that.
So you would first have to, for example, you did the TMA example, you would first have to say, look, this is an area where we think there might be issues, and you'd do some more work on that model, and then you would work on, I don't know, taxiing or whatever, and all the other specific situations where you think it might throw out some important lessons. Is that right?
Yeah, so in general, so often you do first, well, a more general, maybe more qualitative analysis to look where relevant issues may be, and what are quite complex to analyze. And so what for those cases, the kind of models that we developed can be best applied. So there are a lot of interactions, a lot of agents within in the operation, and then it's often most suitable to apply those kind of agent-based models.
Okay. Question coming back to critical observability. If you were to have an output for every transition in the state diagram, then everything would be observable.
No.
Or not. And then you could reduce. I'm looking for a method to make it observable and then reduce it to throw away the things that you don't want to observe, but at least to have everything that you need to observe observable.
No, even if you have an output for every transition, you can get a system that is not observable, because you can get the same sequence of outputs for two different states. Because it depends where, okay. So you get some conditions that can be critical, and states that can be critical and not critical with the same outputs.
So is there no method to make this critical observability automatable?
Yes, this is what I was saying. There is a method for understanding how from the original system get observability. So not every system is observable, but you can get observability, and you have algorithms that tell you where to put outputs and how to put these outputs in such a way that you get observability. Yes, there is one.
I thought this was still ad hoc.
At least when the system is an automaton. Now, if the system is hybrid, it is a little more difficult, because of course observability is due to the output of the continuous time system. So much more difficult, especially if it is non-linear. But
thank you.